Hello everyone, and welcome to Dechert On Reg, the podcast where we explore the ever-changing landscape of financial regulations and the key issues that are shaping the future of asset management. I'm Angelo Lercara, a partner at Dechert and co-head of our regulatory product line. And in each episode, we'll be joined by expert colleagues and guests to explore the most pressing issues in financial regulation. In today's episode, we're talking about the UK anti-greenwashing and ESG regime, which will have an impact on fund managers and distributors. So whether you're an industry insider or simply interested in the world of financial regulation, you don't want to miss this episode of Dechert on Reg. I'm excited to have Mikhaelle, Schiappacasse and Simon Wright joining us today to discuss this exciting topic. Let's dive in. Hi, Mikhaelle. Hi, Simon.
Hi, Angelo. Good to be here.
Hi, Angelo. Good to see you again.
In November of last year, after some delay and extensive industry consultation, the UK regulator, the Financial Conduct Authority, published a policy statement on sustainability disclosure requirements, the SDR, and investment labels. I think it's also known as the FCA's anti-greenwashing rule. Before we get into the details of the rule, what is actually greenwashing, and why do we need an anti-greenwashing rule? Mikhaelle, would you like to start with that?
Sure. Thank you, Angelo. Like many things in the sustainability space, there isn't really an agreed definition about what greenwashing is. But I think the simplest way to think about it is it's a sort of an overstatement of the environmental or the social characteristics or outcomes pursued or delivered by an investment product or a firm itself where it's providing, say, investment management or advisory services. It's basically, fundamentally, when you're looking at it in the asset management space, a mis-selling risk in terms of a product, looking at its sustainability qualities. So given the risks of greenwashing, the FCA and other regulators, so this overstatement, other regulators have been looking at instituting anti-greenwashing rules, and they're doing it in different ways. In this particular case, we have a rule that is part of the FCA's policy statement on sustainability disclosure requirements. There's a much more involved rules around other aspects, but they've tried to approach it in a way of saying essentially that you need to be transparent about the sustainability goals and features of a product. We need to level the playing field through that transparency. And that transparency will provide market confidence and give investors the access to products that actually meet their sustainability goals. So that's essentially what's trying to be achieved here. Other regulators, for example, might do it through naming requirements or talking about what you can and cannot say in terms of specific sustainability points in documentation.
So the FCA's anti-greenwashing rule, what is it actually? Why is it a big deal? Simon?
It's a big deal, effectively, because it's a fairly clear rule that applies to all FCA-regulated firms. So prior to the rule coming into force at the end of the month, any communication that an FCA-regulated firm makes only had to be fair, clear, and not misleading, whereas now there's this anti-greenwashing overlay to it that effectively sets out that if you're talking about the social or environmental characteristics of that product or service, it has to be consistent with those social or environmental characteristics.
Okay, understood. But it sounds very broad. What do you need to do actually to be clear, fair, not misleading in terms of ESG? Is there any guidance? Is there any applicable guidance from the regulator?
If you make a reference to the sustainability characteristics of your products or service as an FCA regulated firm, the reference needs to effectively be set up against four tests. It needs to be correct and capable of being understood. It needs to be complete. And also, if you make a comparison to other products or services, they need to be fair or meaningful. And what the FCA has done in its guidance is actually issue some sort of fairly helpful examples as to what those four things actually mean in practice. So to look at the guidance in a bit more detail, if a sustainability reference is correct and capable of being substantiated, they cite an example of the fact that, you know, something is described as fossil fuel free, but if that fossil fuels are used in the product or service, that clearly isn't correct and can't be substantiated. Another example is that in the context of a comparison, they make the point that if, say, for greenhouse gas emissions, you only did a comparison of one type of greenhouse gas emission rather than the full suite of them, you can't say when describing the sustainability characteristic of a product or service that you've made a comparison that is fair or meaningful. So the detail is in the guidance, but that there is sort of fairly common sense examples as to what this means in practice.
It's essentially, this is, and just to pick up on this rule and what Simon said there, it's a very broad rule, right? It applies to any communication to a client that's about sustainability matters, essentially. So we're not talking purely, you know, financial promotion in the terms of offering documentation. It can be any type of communication, including things that are put on websites, pitch books. It's a very broad in the scope of what it's trying to cover through the rulemaking. And it covers, you know, not just statements that are being made by that firm, but also statements that it's approved to be made by that firm. So very broad in scope in terms of the types of communications captured.
Yeah, I'd agree with that. And again, just to pick up there, communicate in this context has a specific meaning, an extended meaning. So communication, it's communications in any way, including a communication to be made or directed. So, you know, to the extent you're even considering talking about sustainability characteristics in the UK as a UK regulated firm, you need to be very mindful of this rule will bite, and be aware that, you know, whilst it's a rule that the FCA can enforce, it's still possible for a private individual to enforce against the firm as well if you're in breach. So, you know, it does have real teeth.
So what I understand is that the rule is clearly focused on communications of UK firms within the UK. But what about non-UK firms or products? What if I'm a non-UK manager? Do I need to worry about it?
Yeah, so essentially, as you say, Angelo, it applies to in UK communications by UK authorized firms, right? That is what the rule is built around. As I think I mentioned a little bit earlier, it also applies to communications that are approved by UK firms for communication within the UK. So you'd have to imagine, given how broadly this is drafted, that if you have a firm, a non-UK firm with even a non-UK product that then's marketing that product into the UK, and it does it through the auspices of a UK firm, which is in scope, the rules, because they apply to that in scope UK firm, would apply to the marketing activities that are undertaken in respect of a non-UK manager or non-UK provider in terms of a non-UK product. So there's that particular way. And I think, you know, one of the things that we should probably talk about is the anti-greenwashing rule is the foundation of the naming and marketing rule for funds under the SDR, which we mentioned previously, the broader rules around sustainability disclosures passed by the FCA. And there are very specific rules that apply if non-UK products are marketed into the UK under recognized products or marketed in the UK to retail investors. Certain disclosures are required in order to make it clear that they are outside of scope of a number of the rules around disclosures for sustainability products. So there are various ways that it can be captured, but essentially it's through the services of a UK entity.
Yeah, so along the short of it, you'll always need a UK nexus here. You've got to be marketing in the UK, and you'll need to have a UK regulated firm involved in the marketing process. And if you say we're a non-EUA firm marketing non-UKA firm marketing a non-UKA directly into the UK, in theory, you're not caught, but query how you'd actually be in the UK to start off with without carrying on FCA regulated activity.
Right. What about the, you know, consumer versus professional clients? So with regard to the labeling, would that also have an impact on, you know, marketing funds to professional investors?
So the greenwashing rule is somewhat different from the labeling and the naming rules, Angelo, that you're highlighting there, in that it applies across the board to any communications to any clients. So it doesn't matter whether or not those clients are retail customers or not. Obviously, there are additional sensitivities that arise if you are communicating to retail clients, because you've got the consumer duty rules that sort of layer on top of them. And I might see if Simon wants to add anything around the consumer duty rules. But for these rules, no difference between retail and non-retail communications.
All right, thanks. Okay, so I think, Simon, you mentioned it at the very beginning. It's going to be implemented end of this month. So as of next month, the rule will be applicable. Are there any other pending anti-greenwashing rules in the UK coming?
Yeah, I mean, this rule, as I said, comes into force on the 31st of May. Yes, the UK has got a different anti-greenwashing and ESG regime to the EU, as we know. And that is coming in a phased approach broadly over the course of this and next year. So effectively, the labelling regime, which sets out when you can use a sustainability label for a UK AIF or a UK UCITS managed by a UK Manco or UK AIF, and that comes into force at the end of July. And then the naming and marketing rules, which Mikhaelle alluded to, i.e. setting out what you can and can't say when you market various in-scope products to retail clients, again, they come into force on the 2nd of December. And again, you know, it's worth making a point that this is very much a UK-focused regime in terms of the UK product as well as the UK manager. So as it stands at the moment, if you are a non-UK manager of a non-UK product, you're outside of scope of the labelling regime. And also, in most circumstances, outside of scope of the naming and marketing regime, albeit there is a pending FCA consultation about extending that scope to non-UK funds, so-called overseas funds, because clearly at the moment, I don't think the policy intention is to sort of basically put non-UK funds outside of scope of the UK ESG regime. That just seems an unintended consequence and something that, you know, the regulators are looking to address.
Okay, interesting. Well, Mikhaelle, Simon, a big thank you for joining us and sharing your insights with us. We really appreciated your expertise, and it's been great having you in this conversation. Thanks a lot.
Thanks, Angelo.
Thank you.
As we wrap up today's episode, I'd like to extend my thanks to our esteemed guests and colleagues for sharing their valuable insights and expertise. I would also like to thank to our incredible production team. It is their dedication and hard work behind the scenes that make this podcast possible. So here's to our talented producers, sound engineers, and everyone else involved in bringing this show to life. To our listeners, thank you for tuning in to our financial regulatory podcast. We hope that you found today's episode informative and engaging. If you enjoyed the show, please consider subscribing, rating, and reviewing us on your favorite podcast platform. See you next time.